Dr. Ramani, let's start talking about what self-sabotaging is. Mm-hmm.
So self-sabotaging literally is what it sounds like. It's when a person literally undercuts their ability typically to achieve a goal. So, or an intention of any kind. It doesn't even have to be as aspirational as a goal. It's just even daily health habits, from getting a decent night's sleep, to eating healthy, to brushing their teeth. I mean, mm-hmm. it can be any of small health habits, big health habits. And they almost set things up in a way, not intentionally, but in a way that they're not even fully aware of, that all but guarantees a fail. And I always tell my clients that self-sabotage is a way to support your dysfunctional hypothesis. So if your hypothesis is, I'm a failure, and then all these self-sabotage-y things come out, there's a certain satisfaction at the end of the day saying, hey, look, I'm a failure. You know, like there's this almost very upside down kind of win that takes place. And I have to say self-sabotage in some form plagues over half of the clinical population I work with. And that when they're able to see it, they don't even think of it at the time, but it's almost as though they come to each session presenting the week's failures to me.
Wow.
You know, like yeah. like a prize, like a confirmation. At least I was right about that, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And that I sometimes wonder if the self-sabotage, which is then associated with the whatever negative position they're trying to maintain, becomes the one part of their life they can control.
Wow. That was so beautifully said. Mm-hmm. Grace, when you're working with clients, what are some common ways that people self-sabotage?
One that came to mind as I was listening to Dr. Ramani share is about finances. A fascinating form of self-sabotage could be, let's say, for example, you really respect your father and the most he ever made was $75,000 a year. And all of a sudden, you in your adult life can't seem to ever make more than $75,000 a year. And in the process of hypnotherapy, you come to understand that it would be disrespectful to earn more than your father.
Mm-hmm. Whoa. Mm-hmm.
And so that's common. Also, if you don't believe you're worthy or deserving of earning a certain amount, and another massive one is if you hate rich people. Mm-hmm. Because again, your subconscious is here to keep you safe. So if somebody cuts you off in a regular car and you're annoyed that they've done that, but you move on with your day, but then somebody cuts you off in a Corvette. And it's not just that they were a rude driver, it's they're that rich,
right?
Must be nice. Your subconscious will never allow you to become something you hate, ever. And so what happens is money comes in, it goes out. Or you don't have the confidence to ask for the raise that you're worthy and deserving of. Or you don't go for the positions that would actually compensate you in the way that you are worthy and deserving of. So there are so many ways that we self-sabotage, but one of the most fascinating ways is financially.
Yeah, I've never understood this hatred towards rich people. And I have people in my life, they hate them.
Yeah.
And I go, why? And they just really think they're greedy and hate other people. Mm-hmm. But I could see how that could bubble up and affect your life. In addition to finances, what type of consequences have you seen from people who subconsciously self-sabotage?
The maintenance of negative mood states. So the maintenance of, and when I say negative mood states, also negative mood cognitions, like nothing's ever going to get better. I'm never going to get out of this job. I'm never going to live someplace else. It's a lot of absolute words like nevers and alwayses, which is very much part of depressive talk.
Yes.
So it's a stuckness in where they are in life in terms of, I'm never going to do this. I can't do that. I'm never going to be normal weight. I'm never going to get married. Ooh. I'm never going to own a home. I'm never going to finish school. It's, you know, again, a lot of it is associated with things that are meaningful goals or aspirations that they are convinced they'll never get to, but yet not a single choice in their life is getting them closer to that place. And when something does get them closer, it's as though it's so uncomfortable that they change course, not actively. They're not saying, oh, I'm getting too close to marriage. I'm looking to self-sabotage, so let me mess that up. It is after, when you do the deconstruction of it, they'll say, you're absolutely right. That is exactly what I did, but I wasn't aware of it. They weren't aware of it.
Wow. And I think to your point about control, this becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? And the interesting thing and the sad thing is the vast majority of our subconscious beliefs are formed before the age of 7. And so we have this self-fulfilling prophecy of who we're supposed to be in the world, how we're meant to behave, the good things that will happen to us or the bad things that will happen to us. And we create this self-fulfilling prophecy because of subconscious limiting beliefs. We sabotage and sabotage until they become true to have some semblance of control. But if you can upgrade those limiting beliefs, then there's nothing to sabotage.
So it's critical then for parents to set their kids up for during the first 7 years of their lives.
But that means the parents have done the work.
Yes.
So the parents have their own limiting beliefs.
Yes.
And it's what happens intergenerationally is that the limiting beliefs are transferred generation over generation over generation until one generation finally catches it, does the work, and hopefully then may then push forward different lessons in their kids. But it's really, really hard because this stuff is so entrenched.
Now, you've shared a limiting belief on MedCircle.
I got nothing but. I'm like, I'm a walking limiting belief. You know that.
Hardly. But yours resonated with a lot of our viewers, which was, I am not enough.
Yeah, I'm not enough.
And we consider that a limiting belief.
Very much so. Very much so.
Can people identify their own limiting beliefs, or do they have to go see a therapist, or do they have to go into hypnotherapy?
I think here's where it gets tricky, because it becomes so much your identity, right? You know, that I am not enough, you know, I am not worthy, I am not deserving. And so that kind of deconstruction, I think in some ways it's hard to do. I want you to imagine a big, fancy, like decorative, you know, you know, Asian rug kind of thing, Persian rug, and has an incredible pattern in it. And if you were a bug in that rug, you wouldn't know there was a pattern to that rug. It's only by getting a little bit of the drone perspective on the rug, or even just standing over the rug, you'll say, oh, look, this is a rug of flowers and other patterns. But if you're in the rug, you can't see it. And the idea of therapy is to give you the more of the bird's eye view on the rug. And so that's really what it is you're so entrenched in your own stuff that kind of self-study can be very hard. Because remember, this is your belief. So how are you, it starts becoming, the reasoning starts turning in on itself. Like, I believe this. It's, you have to become your own personal flat earther. You know, like,
that's a question.
Right, because you're convinced the earth is round, right?
Right?
I believe the earth's round. I hope you believe the earth is round. Earth is round, right?
Yep.
I am now telling these clients who I am not enough, I'm not enough. I'm like, earth is flat.
That's all. That's
you are enough.
Yeah.
You see the thing?
Yes.
And so that's a really, really tough sell. And that's, so that twist on a fundamental belief, we're taking the sun, making it rise in the west.
Yes.
And then when they're done trying to say, but actually it was always east.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's a lot of work.
Wow.
It's a lot of work.
You know, something we always say is you can't read the label if you're in the bottle.
Right.
That's why people ask me, do I do my own hypnotherapy sessions with myself? No. I do self-hypnosis to relax and to put myself into a calmer state, absolutely. But I can't do my own work because I'm in the bottle. I'm not reading the label.
Do you see a hypnotherapist?
I do.
And you see a therapist.
I see a traditional therapist.
See?
Absolutely.
Clinical psychologist, seeing a psychologist, hypnotherapist, seeing a hypnotherapist.
Yes.
That just shows that you guys practice what you preach.
Yes.
And you believe.
You have to.
The power of what you both do.
Yeah.
When, Dr. Ramani, when you're working with people, with your patients on identifying these limiting beliefs and working on navigating the negative thoughts, the emotions and behaviors, you use a process called whiteboarding. What is that?
Okay, so, and I hate that it's called whiteboarding because it sounds like a little form of torture.
Like waterboarding?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So here's what will happen is, not always during client sessions, but sometimes when the client's sort of hitting me, especially with something chain of beliefs going to dysfunctional thoughts and behaviors, I start sketching it out. In fact, when I keep my patient files, I use diagrams instead of text as much because it helps me see interrelationships. But when you can show it to the client, and so I'll have a whiteboard or paper or something, but often a whiteboard so we can erase things, you literally say, here's the thought, the belief, and here's the behavior, and here's the detour we want to make. And when they can see it pictorially, it makes all the difference in the world to see how these things connect. And over the course of the session, we add all of these other satellites to it so they can start seeing how all of this stuff that seems random to them is really interconnected, and then always getting them to the same sort of dysfunctional destination. And it's really about, now we can say, look, you see how we can just, all we need to do is tweak this thought a little bit, or help you see the temporariness of this thought, and then erase lines and move diagrams. You're doing it in real time.
When the cameras weren't rolling, I was saying that when I go out in public, I dress like a schlob. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, whatever I can find, I just throw it on and I go. And I had told myself it's because I don't care. But I wonder if it's because I have a limiting belief that I will not find a romantic partner that I will love and be obsessed with and want to spend, you know, my life with. Hopefully not actually obsessed. But maybe I am that self-fulfilling prophecy of, well, if I go out in public looking like a schlob, then I am now correct, because who's going to want to approach a schlob? Or if I approach somebody, who would want to interact with that? Is this what you're talking about with whiteboarding?
So what you do, you'd say, like, I go out dressed like a slob.
Yeah.
Okay? Your original direct line would be, because I'm indifferent. I don't care.
Right.
And result of that, in your mind, is I didn't waste a lot of time. I got it done. I got to my damn comfortable.
Yeah.
Then I'm going to say, Kyle, can you give me an alternative path? Just give me an alternative path. Why are you dressed like this? You're like, because then I then, well, maybe because nobody will approach me. Okay, nobody will approach you. And then what's the downstream effect of that? You'll say, well, then I'm not going to meet someone when I go out. And then what's the effect of that? Then I get to maintain my big belief that nobody's interested in me and I'm always going to be alone. But by laying that out graphically, your traditional, very simple, I like to be in sweats, I'm comfortable, I'm too cool for school, gets transferred into, I'm going to die alone.
Right.
So how do I know if I really just don't care and like sweatpants, or I really do believe that I will not find somebody?
Well, I mean, part of it is an unpacking. In this particular case, some of it may be that it's how almost incongruous or uncomfortable that state is for you. That this sense of, I keep going out of the house poorly dressed. And at some point you reflect, is this an uncomfortable thing for me? Why am I doing this? Like, you actually, it gets attention for you. Some people say, listen, I love dressing casually. Yeah. It's how I feel. They may be meeting people left and right. That's not their story. So it's really whether this thing is even a thing, as it were, you know, because for someone else, they might say, I'm not even paying attention to this, but they may focus on other elements of their presentation, or that someone else might say, I now only get my groceries from mail order, from this app and that app and that app, and I'm not leaving the house.
Yeah.
So it may be less about the sweatpants and more about, I'm so efficient, I only use apps. Alternative, I'm not leaving the house, so I don't have to see people, so I'm always gonna be alone. So you see what I'm saying? It all depends on what that thing is. And so it may come down to the therapeutic issue you bring in is not the app or the sweatpants, but I'm not dating. Right. And I'm unhappy about that. Then we do the back construction.
Right.
That's, I don't think anyone's coming into therapy saying, I wear sweatpants.
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what going to be my point. Is someone would come in and say, why am I still alone?
Yes.
And then through that, you figure out, oh, here are all the ways in which I'm sabotaging my ability to meet somebody.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And going even deeper into perhaps something in childhood, more often than not, a belief that's unhelpful about the dangers of a relationship, or the dangers of being left by somebody you love, et cetera.
Yes, that's it. So we go from, you know, an app for food delivery to primitive fears about aloneness. But but then there has to be that therapeutic question of, why am I not meeting anyone?
Wow. Okay. I just had like great therapy right now. That was excellent. Yeah. Okay. So now when you work with clients, you use the reframing technique that you mentioned in our first session. Can you expand on that a little more?
Absolutely. So reframing is a technique where you go back to the initial sensitizing event of an issue. What that means is the first time it happened. Mm-hmm. So let's say somebody comes to me and they say, I'm experiencing, well, this is a good example. This was in my first book. Somebody says, I'm biting my nails at work. I'm biting them down to the point where they bleed. Oh. I'm embarrassed. It's gross. It's unsanitary. And I know that my colleagues think less of me because of it. Not to mention, I'm so sick of my mother telling me to cover up my hands and put my gloves on and that it's gross. So we regress back to the initial sensitizing event, to the source of when she first started biting her nails. She's 6 years old. She's in kindergarten. She's in a little cubby like this, and the girl next to her, they're supposed to be coloring quietly, whispers to her over and over again, whispering to her about whatever. And so she turns to her and whispers back, we're supposed to be quiet, but the teacher only hears that. So the teacher comes over, and to my client, who now she's there in her childhood memory, not only says to her, why aren't you following directions? Why are you speaking when I told you to be silent? Why are you coloring outside of the lines? And she picks up her drawing and tapes it to the board and tells everyone what not to do. She's mortified. And all of a sudden she's looking under her desk and she starts picking at her cuticles. So it wasn't even the first moment that she bit her nails, but it was the first time she felt so much anxiety and her body didn't know how to process it or what to do, mm-hmm. that this is how it attempted to make sense of that. So she's coming to me thinking, similarly to, oh, I'm dressing this way, right? Mm-hmm. No, she's coming to me saying, I'm biting my nails. But the real issue is her body doesn't know how to process embarrassment and anxiety. Mm-hmm. And it started all the mm-hmm. way in sixth mm-hmm. grade. So reframing is a very powerful process. Now, it does not rewire the memory. It does not change reality. It doesn't change what actually happened. But what you do is in that theta state and that meditative state, for example, you could visualize adult her coming in and saving the day. Adult her coming in, kneeling down next to her and saying, I know you were just telling her to be quiet. Mm-hmm. Thank you for following the rules. Mm-hmm. I love your drawing. Have you ever heard of Jackson Pollock? You could be a big famous modern artist one day. Mm-hmm. And then in this exact session, the adult her going over and looking into the teacher's eyes, who, you know, she hated the whole life, mm-hmm. and seeing such a tired woman. Mm. A tired woman, and feeling empathy for her, still not believing in her methods, mm-hmm. but actually feeling compassion for her. And so what happens is reality. What actually happened, happened, but her subconscious now views this as an empowering learning experience. And so she approaches life differently because we reframed it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So one of the ways that I explain it to my students is, if you imagine the Statue of Liberty doubling over and laughing hysterically, and because she's laughing hysterically, everybody in the tri-state area starts mm-hmm. laughing along with her, right? We know she's a statue. She hasn't moved. She's totally there. But just by imagining her laughing, we start to feel better. Mm-hmm. It's that times 100. Mm-hmm. So you go back, you reframe the experience as a positive, all because you want to live the present moment from a more empowered place. So what happens? She stops biting her nails.
Now, I don't have a problem picking my nails, but I do it.
Yeah.
I don't remember the first time I did it. How right. do I remember that?
So you're actually not remembering. So in your subconscious, everything you've ever experienced in this lifetime has been stored. It's one of the reasons why they're starting to use hypnotherapy for eyewitness identification. Because when you're stressed out, your memory recall is terrible.
Oh, I bet.
But when you're in the theta state, your memory recall is vastly improved. So we also have a lot of people coming to us to study for their MCATs and their LSAT, because when you're really stressed, you don't have that memory mm-hmm. recall. But if you can do self-hypnosis and relax into the theta state and take your test, all of a sudden all this information comes back to you. So we actually say to our clients, you're not remembering, you're actually going back. And we have them visualize, sometimes even getting in a little time travel device. Again, you're in a meditative state, mm-hmm. and you visualize going back to that time, and it's fascinating. You snap your fingers and they're there and they're six and they're crying as if it's happening right now.
Wow.
And it's very, very powerfully, you know, powerful to heal it from that place, because what we would view as a trauma as an adult is not what you view as a trauma when you're six.
Yes. This reminds me of somatic experiencing. Mm-hmm. Do you see the overlaps there?
I do. I see a lot of it. And again, a lot of what, you know, you're describing, Grace, is also some of the work that's done in other models like EMDR of going
yes.
into early memories, traumatic memories, and then you start sometimes even more recent, work your way back, go deeper and deeper, mm-hmm. but then through the techniques of EMDR, not let it sort of allow you to dissociate, but you sort of can stay with it. So I absolutely see that. And any kind of traumatic memory is going to get wired somatically, mm-hmm. you know, so it's the, and for them, it's really about the idea that you may not even have the direct memory anymore, but you're physiologically experiencing what are often termed triggers.
Yes.
You know, that something happens and you're physiologically feeling it, like, what is happening? A person's almost surprised at the physiological reaction they're having to something.
There are people who have experienced incredible trauma, and they are afraid to go to a therapist, mm-hmm. and they're afraid to go to a hypnotherapist, mm-hmm. because they can't even imagine having to re-experience, discuss, mm-hmm. or bring up that traumatic event in their life. Mm-hmm. So I want to hear from both of you on what you would tell that person they could expect when they work with you and go back to that really traumatic experience.
I tell them there is no time clock on this one. There is no schedule on this. That it will happen. It will come. and you will trust the space and you will trust me. They've been traumatized, Kyle. Yeah. The last thing I'm going to do is put them on a schedule and say, you have to go mm-hmm. there, right? They've already had that violation. Not going to happen on my watch. So mm-hmm. I'll say, you'll get there. And I'll see it, that they'll start getting closer. And then they'll ask me, they'll say something ridiculous or like, oh, a bird just flew into the window, and I mm-hmm. see what's happening. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I'll let them talk about the bird that flew into the window, and then we'll slowly steer back. I've had clients who, once we get to the traumatic moment, we're about to talk about it, they'll stop coming for a few weeks. And I remember in one case in particular, he said, can we have the next session by phone? And I said, yes. And then again, it detailed, you know, sexual abuse as a child mm-hmm. that he had experienced. He'd never shared with anyone. Mm-hmm. And he said, I have so much shame. I couldn't look at your face. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And that's happened more than once to me mm-hmm. that people have said, I want to share this the first time, not looking at your face. That was about shame. And instead of saying, no way, you're going to face me down and tell me, I say, whatever way it's comfortable. I say, you can even write it down mm-hmm. and I can read it, and I can even turn my back to you and read it. And like, I want them to believe, however they bring that into the room, they bring it in their own way. Listen, Kyle, some people open with it. Mm-hmm. Some people take months or years to get to it. Mm-hmm. There is no right answer. The struggle becomes because some people are on a limited amount of mental health sessions they can get. Mm-hmm. Some people, unfortunately, aren't given the time they need mm-hmm. to get to that place. That's a systems problem. But I think clients should take the time they need.
In order to feel recovered and feel peace and accomplish what people are trying to accomplish when they go to a therapy, do they have to go to that place?
It's a great question. I think because it's often it's the energetic backstory. It's hard to not go to that place okay. and be able to make the progress. I will tell you this. Let's say the story of someone's trauma is this deep, mm-hmm. okay? And maybe we only get this deep into the story. They don't give me the exact details, the exact things that happened to them. Mm-hmm. They cannot unearth that. They don't feel like they can unearth it. Sometimes I'll refer them to people who do only trauma work mm-hmm. and I'll do another form of work with them. So that sometimes happens, but then this is where we are, but we know that there's been a breach of trust and et cetera, et cetera. You'll see, like, for example, we see this, people who have had sexual trauma. They'll often feel pain in the quadrants or mm-hmm. parts of their bodies where the abuse took place. And, you know, a good therapist that's not going to go lost on them. You know, yes. We pay attention to that. We bring that in. It's interesting. You brought up pain in this area. Can I ask? And they'll, no, I don't want to talk about it.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, but I just want you to know, I noticed that. And sometimes the next week they'll say, can we go back to that? It needs time to percolate. But I think that to have trauma and have it never, ever, ever be brought up, there's an elephant in the room.
Got it. Grace,
absolutely.
What do you think?
Well, hypnotherapy is not effective unless you desire the result. So if somebody didn't want to return to their trauma, it wouldn't be effective anyway. That having been said, if somebody wants to return to the trauma to heal it, but they're terrified, again, hypnotherapy is effective because you're feeling safe. Mm-hmm. We use a tool where we actually project it onto a movie screen. And we say, you've already lived through this. You don't need to live through it again. You can sit in the audience and we're just going to observe this on a movie screen. Mm. Now, I do find that's not quite as transformative as going back in first person. Mm-hmm. However, it allows us to go back and it allows mm-hmm. them to face it. And it's a beautiful stepping stone. And from there, you can do very powerful mm-hmm. reframing work. But I completely agree, it's up to their timeline. And I had a client once who, she was so incredibly brave. She was raped, and because she, you know, one of the things that the body does to keep us safe is buries memories. Mm-hmm. And that's not a terrible thing when it first happens. Mm-hmm. It's keeping us safe. We don't always want everything up in our face. But she wanted to remember details so she could take this person to court. And so basically she wanted to return to the event as often as she needed to understand the full picture. And at first we started on the screen. And after that, she felt comfortable enough to return back in first person. And she wanted to remember everything, so we didn't do any reframing until the very end because she had all the details she needed. And then in the final session, we did a reframe where basically her decision of that reframe was to just not go on the date in the first place. Mm. And so she found that very empowering. Mm. But she was able to go into court with full clarity of what happened. And it was very beneficial to the trial. Mm. And I commend her. What a terrifying thing to do.
Yeah.
I
love that people are hearing both sides of this mm-hmm. because they do overlap
a lot.
But there's also some unique aspects to each mm-hmm. side. And when you give people options, it also gives another sense of control for them. You know, so many of our viewers haven't felt or even been in control for a long time. And now this is another choice that you can make. You don't just have to go to a hypnotherapist. You don't just have to go to a therapist. You can try.
Best outcomes, to be perfectly honest, of most of my clients are when they're working with both.
I agree.
Because we don't diagnose. And that's not actually our function, right? Our function is to help people relax deeply and visualize a different outcome in the theta state. That's what we're an expert at. So I think certainly if something's calling to you, one or the other is better than nothing. But in an ideal, perfect world, you'd be able to benefit from both modalities that we've been discussing here.
Well, in our next session, Grace will talk about her four steps to mental freedom. And we'll also talk about how clinical therapy and ACT, along with hypnotherapy, can help with binge eating.